Good morning. We welcome you here in the sanctuary. We welcome you online. I want to remind you that sermon notes and the announcements are listed on Facebook if you would like to download those or pull them up so that you can use them. If today's your first day here, this is God's house. This is His home. It's your home. We're so thankful that you are worshiping here today. There are several announcements in your bulletin. The Staff Parish Relations Committee will meet tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. Run for God meets on Tuesdays at 6 in the Fellowship Hall. All Saints Sunday is November 7th. If you have a name of someone who has died in the last year and you would like for us to recognize that person, then please call the church office. We need to hear from you by October the 27th at noon. Also, there's several other announcements, but you can check them out in your bulletin.
Good morning, everyone. I'm so happy to see all of you here this morning. The choir is going to get started with our call to worship, and then I'm going to bring you all in so that we can sing our first praise and worship song together.
Let us remain standing for our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. Let us say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Let's take a moment to center on God, inviting the presence of His Holy Spirit to direct us in worship. On the back of your bulletin is a list of names. If you have anybody you'd like to add to this list, please feel free to do so. We want to remember the Dexter Bostick family, the Susie Parks family, the brother Rich Cassis family, and his wife Gina Cassis. Both of them died with COVID this past week. Let's remember Margaret Pitts, Pace Clark, Carolyn Stepp having surgery tomorrow. Tommy Beasley's going to have surgery. They just haven't set a date yet for him. Grayson Posey had surgery. I think he's doing fine. Renee Kreitz said to tell you thank you so much. She had no fear as she went in to have her surgery this week. Let's remember Danielle Gooch. Betty Boyd was supposed to have surgery, but it got postponed again. Let's remember London Perry, Judy McCreary, Carly Tedford, and Sue Tate. Are there any others that you'd like to lift up this morning? Okay, there was a lady who had a stroke at the football game. Okay, so we'll pray for her. Somebody else out here? Okay, let's be in prayer for Mike Whitehead's family. He passed away last night. Any others? All right, let's go to God remembering these concerns and lifting ourselves unto the Lord. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that Christ Jesus has come into this world to give us guidance and direction for our lives. Lord, if not, we would be living lives of futility. We would be trying to save ourselves, earn our salvation, impress other people, try to live according to the pressures of our society, instead of looking to you. But in Christ Jesus, we have forgiveness, we have healing, and we have a calling to be the people that you created us to be. Our life is not futile. Our life is filled instead with the joy of knowing your salvation, with the hope of living in harmony with you, and of a future on this earth and in heaven where we walk side by side with our Master. We just thank you, gracious God, that you love us this much and you give us hope in the face of trials and tribulations. We pray for that hope for each one that we've lifted up today. Our prayer list is much longer than the names we've called out loud. And I'm sure there's people that we've forgotten to name or that we've just chosen not to say out loud. Please count this prayer for them. Bless them deep in their heart. May they know that you love them. Father, may they know that we love them too. And we ask, gracious God, that you would guide our church as we're trying our best to serve you. We're trying to grow in our faith. We're trying to tell other people about the saving love of Jesus. We're trying to do actual things where we reach out to help people who are downtrodden and who are in need. So we ask, gracious God, that you would bless us as we try to fulfill the ministry to which you have called us. We pray, dear Lord, for our country. We pray for the challenges that we face. I know there are elections coming up. They're already having their campaigns and working hard at the different things that they have. There are some bills that they're trying to pass in Congress, Lord, that might help all of us if our leadership could work together and find a way to compromise. And we pray that they will. We're the leading country in the world right now. And Father, the world looks to us for guidance and direction. We need our guidance and direction from you. So we pray that you would guide and lead our elected officials so that they're doing the things that you have empowered them to do and that you're guiding them to make the best decisions. We pray, Father, where there's hostility and hurt, where people have words that injure, where they send text messages that are daggers in the heart, where they do things on social media that just destroy people. Father, that's not who we are called to be. We're called to be the people who encourage people and build them up. So help us not to be part of that cancel culture stuff. Help us to be a part of the culture that's based in Christ Jesus, who says, I love you, and come to me if you're heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Those are the things that we want to do. That's the kind of people that we want to be. That's the kind of nation that we want to live in. And so, Father, help us to set the example so that others can learn from us and follow into your love and grace. Father, we pray for this COVID. It's just annihilated our world. It's affected our economies. It's claimed so many lives of so many people worldwide. It doesn't respect anybody. You can be wealthy. You can be poor. You can be somewhere in the middle. It does not care. But Lord, we know that you care and that you want good things for your people. So we pray for deliverance from this pandemic that has swept the face of our earth. We pray, Father, for a way to find out how to survive economically. We have all these goods and floating around in the Pacific Ocean. We can't even get them delivered into the port. And then once they're in the port, we can't get them delivered across our country. Father, we need help trying to figure out an answer to these things, an answer to employment. Our companies can't find people to work for them. Lord, we're just not smart enough on our own, but we know that you are. You have a way forward for us and a way forward for everyone in our world. We pray that we can listen and find that way forward. Father, if there's someone here today who knows not how to pray, for whom no one is praying, we know, Lord, that you'll count this prayer for them. We know your blessings are for them. We know your blessings are with us. And we pray that these people can know that we're praying for them as well as praying for ourselves. And we remember the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hey, please stand. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 21, it says, For me to live is Christ. So we're going to sing this hymn, My Life is in You, Lord.
Our scripture lesson is taken from Acts chapter 18, verses 22 through 31. Hear now this witness to the word of God. When he had landed at Caesarea, he went up to Jerusalem and greeted the church, and then went down to Antioch. After spending some time there, he departed and went from that place, from place to place, through the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Now there came to Ephesus a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria. He was an eloquent man, well-versed in the scriptures. He'd been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he taught with burning enthusiasm and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, though he knew only the baptism of John. He began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained the way of God to him more accurately. And when he wished to cross over to Achaia, he believed and encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. On his arrival, he greatly helped those who, through grace, had become believers, for he powerfully refuted the Jews in the public, showing them by the scriptures that the Messiah is Jesus. This has been the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God. In response to the reading of God's word, we invite our ushers for our morning tithes and offerings. Gracious God, as we're gathered in your presence here this day, we're mindful of the tremendous blessings that you have poured out upon us. And Father, we thank you for those blessings. And we pray that these gifts can in turn be used as blessings for others. There's so many ways that our congregation tries to reach out into our community. Plus, gracious God, there's so many ways that we try to enable people to be able to grow in their faith. Please bless these gifts. Use them to proclaim the blessed name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. And it's in his name that we lift these gifts to you. Amen. God, from whom all blessings flow, praise him, all creatures here below, praise him above the heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. You may be seated.
If I fall, just roll me under the pew. I'll be good. Thank you. All right. Good deal. Good deal. What? Were you holding out on me? No. Trying to slip it up the sleeve like Trip likes to do sometimes. Pockets? Nothing there. Very good. This is going to go to something else because look where the tube is filled up to. Over the top. We have bought our heifer. You have paid for a heifer to go for a family that is in sore need of help for food and money to just to live. So what's next for us? You have to ask Miss Leah about goats. She knows a lot about goats and their sounds. Yes. We did. Yes, that was Luke's goat named Billy. It was a billy goat. But anyway, we'll be working on this now, and this offering right here will go to that. Good job. Excellent job. All right, we're going to do that. Bible verse. I understand we have some Bible verses this morning.
I am the Lord, and there is no other.
Amen. Amen. Very good, Jack. Yay.
I am the Lord, there is no other. Isaiah 45:5, I think.
Was that yours too? Where from, Isaiah?
Isaiah 45:5.
Very good. Yeah. Very good. Anyone else been working on Bible verses? All right, come on. Let's pick it up. I may start giving us one during Advent. Just there's 4 weeks in Advent. That's coming up soon, and we may learn one for each week. Yeah. Yes. The rake. I've tripped over it twice, and other people have been tripping over it. But at my house, oh my goodness. I don't know about at your house, but I bet there are thousands and thousands of these laying in my yard. And do you see them in your yard too? Your grandma has tons. If it's in a small yard, you might see people having to do all this and rake up. If you see it in big yards, you'll probably see them riding one of those on the lawnmower with the thing, picking them up and getting them up. And as soon as they pick them up, the next day there's what? More. Leaves. These leaves have fallen off the trees and will continue to fall at my house. We better do this because I'm going to move. Oh, I know it. Trip, it makes me want to just take them and do this, but I don't think our custodian would care for that too much. It'd be too much of a mess. But, you know, these things are pretty interesting. If you look at them, I think they all have a story to tell. Some of them they're different sizes. They're different colors. They have different scars on them. Some have been eaten by bugs on the side. Some have gotten torn and broken and have fallen. And some of them, the veins in them, you know, the vein part that run through them, they look differently. See how they look different? They're all different. But they have something in common. That they're all leaves, and they're all dead. They're all dead. They have left their life source, which was a tree or a bush, and therefore they can no longer get what they need to live. The tree is their life source. They get their water and they get their nutrients from a tree. Now, I also found these in my yard or close to my yard. These are called evergreens. They're always green. Now, of course, we've broken off them from a limb. But if you saw these Leland cypress or a cedar, a pine, when even in the wintertime, they stay connected to their tree. So therefore, they never drop off. These things don't drop off. Their leaves do not drop off. Mm-mm. And so they stay green all the time because they are connected to their source. Now, people are like this too. People are connected to a life source. Our life source is God, our Heavenly Father. Very good. And as long as we stay connected to Him, we can do good things. But now, sometimes people forget and they get disconnected from God. They think that maybe the things of this world can make them happy. And we know that there's things that do make us happy for a short period of time. They think there's by doing this or doing that, having this, going there, that's all I need in my life. I just need to be doing that with so-and-so and having this. But that doesn't last long. And then they begin to figure that out, and they get disconnected from God and the things that He gives us through His Son, Jesus Christ. They don't fall and down and die, but they can get separated. And they kind of just like get dried up like people, and everything bothers them, and they don't know what to do, and they get down in the dumps, and they get depressed, and they get worried, and that's what it's like to be separated from God. God is our life source. He fills us first with forgiveness, so we don't have to worry about things. We're forgiven. He fills us with everything we need, and the Bible says to keep us green and fresh, even into our old years and gray hair. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Some of us are there, and we're still fresh. We're still fresh and green, meaning we can still have all the fruit of the Spirit that we've studied, love and joy and peace and patience, because that all comes not from this world with its little sometime happy stuff, but from God who keeps it in there and lives in us. I want to be fresh and green till I just conk out and my gray hair just takes over and I can't see anymore and they're having to push me around probably in a few years, won't be long. And I know that you do too. How do we stay connected to God? We read our Bible. I'm going to guess most of you on this front row can read. If you can't read that well yet, you have someone at your house that loves to read to you, I bet. So read you from the Bible. We're going to pray. Pray is like talking to your friend. That keeps you connected to God. Have you ever had something bothering you and worrying you and pray about it? Yes. You'll find out that that's the one person that can help you. And then being a part of a church, being in a church family, wow, that just keeps us with other Christians that are counting on God to get us through so that we don't get all wilted like these old leaves, but stay fresh and green for a long, long time. Let's remember not to get disconnected. Even at your age, you can talk with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to help you through. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, you have provided everything we need. You're like the trees on this earth and the bushes on this earth. You are our life support, and we give you thanks. Help us to remember that, Lord, when we tend to want to back off and get a little bit lazy and separate ourselves and get disconnected from you. Help us to remember that we can't, like leaves cannot reattach themselves, we can. We can come right back to you, and you welcome us with open arms. We love you, Lord, and thank you for loving us that much. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, y'all want to help clean up the leaves? No, we'll get...
it runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Thank you, choir. Our sermon text is taken from Isaiah chapter 45, verses 5 through 7. Hear now this witness to the word of God. I'm the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. This has been the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we want to know for sure that the things we invest in are things that are of you and that are eternal. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Many of you know that the North Alabama Conference paid for me to go on a cruise to Greece, and they paid for part of my airfare. I'd never been to Greece, and my daughter Caroline got to go with me. While we were there, we went to Athens, and we went up on the Acropolis. The Acropolis is a mountain that overlooks Athens. On top of it, there are several temples that were built to the goddess Athena. The Parthenon is dedicated to her. It's the oldest one. I'm sure you've seen it in pictures and in your history book and all that sort of stuff. And so is the, Erechtheion, I think that's how you say it. Then there's the temple of Athens Nike. Athena is said to be born out of the forehead of the head of the gods, of the Greek gods, Zeus. She was the protector of Athens, among several other identities that she had. So you've seen the picture of the Acropolis, how high it is, a picture of the Parthenon. Now let's look at Athena Nike. Look at how much stone was required to build these buildings. They were built, I think the Parthenon 500s BC, the other two in the 400s BC. They've been there for a long time. They were there when Paul was visiting Athens trying to tell people about Jesus, and they'd been there a long time when he was there. It took a mighty effort to haul all that building material up the side of that mountain and to carve all the statues and frescoes that were in the temples. And as I stood in front of these ancient ruins, I have pictures of me, but all the stuff had, they were doing construction work and they had all this metal stuff on it. So I got pictures off the internet instead of using my pictures. But as I stood in front of them, I thought to myself, how futile all these efforts were. Tremendous time, effort, and resources were expended to build these temples to a goddess and a way of life that was simply not real. It wasn't real. When I was in high school, I took a class called Greek mythology. I liked the class. I liked science fiction. And this class reminded me of science fiction. Yet people believed this. They sacrificed to the goddess Athena. There was even a money box with a statue of Athena on it. When you got married, you had to put money in there. It was a tax to get married. I did a wedding yesterday. The couple had to buy their marriage license. Some things never change. You get taxed whether you live back then. You get taxed whether you live now. There were also temples on the Acropolis to Dionysus. He's the party god of the Greeks and the Romans. And at the bottom of the mountain, there's this huge temple to Zeus. This was a whole life based on fiction, a myth. 2,500 years later, people don't believe that any of this stuff was true. Yet it was a way of life for them. Their worship of their gods was futile and misguided. This is what God told Isaiah about 740 B.C., long before the Parthenon was built. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do these things. Weal means well-being and happiness, and woe means the opposite, things that cause sorrow and distress. God is responsible for the things of the world, and there's no other God to whom we can appeal. Satan has power, but only in the form of deception. He has no power over you unless you allow it. Athena, Dionysus, Zeus, they're not real. From the rising of the sun to the setting of the sun in the west, there is no other God. That about covers it all, don't you think? Now, I believe you're like me. If you want to invest in something, you want it to make a difference. You want it to be worthwhile. Some of you have invested in stocks. You study so that the stock you're invested in is going to be a good investment. It's going to make you some money. You don't want to invest in a loser stock. When you pick a church, you pick a church where you can grow in the Lord. You pick a church where you reach out to try to help other people. You pick a church that tries to tell people about Jesus so that they can share in the joy and love and mercy that we have as part of our faith. When we buy a house, we have that house inspected so that there's no surprises after we bought that house and we find that our investment is no good. We're not interested in investing our time, our effort, and our resources into something that is futile. This is what distressed Paul so much when he went to Athens. Acts chapter 17, verses 16 through 17 says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was deeply distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and also in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. They worshiped, in addition to Athena, Zeus, Dionysus, Apollo, Aphrodite, Hermes, and I'm sure some even It worshiped Hades, the god of the underworld. And those are just starters. There are a lot more gods. Paul was concerned not just for the ones who were worshiping these Greek gods. He also was concerned for the Jews, that they could know that Jesus was the Messiah, that he had come from God to lead people in the way of truth and life. He wanted to bring Jews and Greeks alike to the kingdom established by Jesus with his life and his death on this earth. He tried to explain that though Jesus had been crucified, God had raised him back to life. Hear Jesus' words from John 14, verse 6. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Paul knew this. He knew that the investments that these people were making in their gods were futile and would end in nothing. It's like Isaiah said, I am the Lord and there is no other. Some Epicurean and Stoic philosophers heard Paul and invited him to speak at the Areopagus. It's a smaller hill that stood basically in the shadow of the Acropolis. Boy, aren't those words kind of confusing? You know, what are we talking about here? I went so that I could say I'd been where Paul walked, okay? I just want to be able to say that. And it's just a piece of rock now. But back then, it's where people went to debate all these philosophies. And they got tired of debating the same old stuff, so they loved to hear something new. Paul was proud to be invited to have the opportunity to speak about Jesus. In Acts 17, 22 to 24, this is what he said. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with an inscription to an unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. And he proceeded to bear witness to God as the creator of heaven and earth, who does not live in shrines made by human hands. Wow. He just trashed all those altars, temples that were built on top of the Acropolis. And that humongous temple to Zeus that was built at the bottom of the hill, well, it was nothing either. Indeed, God doesn't need anything made by human hands because God brought everything into existence that exists. Then Paul told how we needed to repent and how Jesus would be the judge of our world. Those who believe will be raised from the dead as Jesus was raised from the dead. And when Paul talked about the resurrection, then the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers dismissed him, although there were a few people who came to believe and accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. There's nothing on that hill now where those debates raged over and over and over. We call it Mars Hill because this was the name of the Roman god of war. I wonder if the people up there at Mars Hill know that. The Greeks called it Ares because their version of the god of war had that name instead of the Roman name. Where all those debates took place, there is nothing. No one believes that Ares is a god. But the God of all creation that Paul bore witness to is still the Lord. And he's the only one who is true. He's the only one who is real. He is the God that we still worship. When you give yourself to God through Jesus Christ, his Son, there is no longer any futility. We have the promise of love, of mercy, and support in this life. And in the life to come, we have the promise of everlasting life by sharing in the resurrection of Jesus. Futility on one hand, servant of the Lord on the other. Which will you choose? Which makes sense to you? So let's ask ourselves, is there something I'm investing in that's futile? Is there something I'm investing in that's eternal? How do we answer such a question? Well, let me just make up an example for you. You see a car that you just would love to have, It's just at the edge of your price range. You can barely afford it, but it puts you under financial strain. What do? Well, of course, you go to God and you pray about it. You ask for God for direction. And what does God tell you? God says, hold off. It's outside your price range. It's going to put you in a terrible bind to do it. But you go back by that showroom floor and you look at that thing and you sign on the dotted line. And your family is so excited for that first month until the bill hits. And then you're looking at all the things you got to give up to be able to drive that fancy car. Oh, yeah. You're not going to be eating out anymore. And those steaks you used to get every once in a while to fix on that fancy grill that you bought, well, you can forget them too, especially now with the way prices are rising up. And those little extras that you did for your kids and your family, well, you can forget that. And you're constantly worrying about money. And because you're worrying about money, you get fussy and irritable. Why? Because you sought to satisfy what you wanted, your own desires, your own lust, instead of listening to what God was trying to tell you. Dave Ramsey, the Christian financial advisor, receives letters like this all the time. And you know what he tells them? Sell that car. Buy something you can afford. Get out from under that payment. When we don't listen to God's direction, the decisions we make are futile. We don't thrive with abundance. You might get by, but it's not with a blessing. Don't give in to your own desires, to your own lust. It doesn't have to be about buying a car. It could be about anything. Hear what 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 to 17 says. Do not love the world or the things in the world. The love of the Father is not in those who love the world. For all that is in the world, the desire of the flesh, the desire of the eyes, the pride in riches, comes not from the Father, but from the world. And the world and its desire are passing away. But those who do the will of God live forever. Amen? Amen. That's right. Well, can you hear the Athenians going, really, preacher? What Greek who helped build the Parthenon would have believed that Athena was not real? But she wasn't. And God is, right? He is. Now, a second temptation to futile thinking is that I can do it all on my own. Are you susceptible to that temptation? I know I am. Ooh, I think I can just do it all on my own. I might not be the smartest preacher on the face of the earth, but I know God has given me gifts and graces to use for Him. And if He didn't want me to use them for Him and to figure things out on my own, well, just why would He have given me those gifts and graces in the first place? You ever think like that? Lord help you if you do. It's a pitiful place to be. If you're subject to this kind of futile thinking, that you can do it all on your own, then please remember what Jesus did when He came to this earth. He recruited a team to work with Him. There were 12 people on that team, and on that team there were 3 insiders in addition to that. Also, when He sent the first group out as missionaries, there were 70 of them, and He sent them out 2 by 2. There were no lone rangers in that midst. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 and 10 says, 2 are better than 1 because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up the other. But woe to the one who is alone and falls and does not have anyone to help. Jesus wanted us to be in church together for the same reason. It's not good to be isolated and to think that you can do it on your own. Jesus invites us to partner with Him. And He says, come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. A third temptation to futile thinking is to believe that you're always right, that your idea is always the best idea. Are any of us prima donnas? Oh, don't raise your hand. I don't want to know. We think it's our way or the highway. Are you married to a prima donna? Don't elbow anybody. We don't want anybody to be hurt. Do you have one for a friend? Are you tired of trying to stroke their egos? If you caught a 5-pound fish, they caught a 6-pound fish. If you got a hole in one on the golf course, well, they've gotten 2 hole in ones. If the prima donna has an opinion, the prima donna will expect for you to listen to their opinion. But if you have an opinion, they don't want to hear it because they've already got it all figured out. I've been in church meetings where the prima donna wants to tell everybody what to do because they think they know the way it has to be and that no one else has a worthy thought. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 12 says, "When pride comes, then come disgrace. But with the humble is wisdom." I like it better what Jesus said in Luke 14, 11. "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." Always remember that it's not our way that's the most important way. It's God's way that's ultimately important. And when we pray, like in the Lord's Prayer, we pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." It's great to have an opinion, but we want to submit our opinion to that of the Lord. We're not always right, but God is. Amen? Boy, that was pretty weak. We're not always right, but God is. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, yeah. We want to do His will on this earth, not our will. No matter how talented we are, no matter how many insights we have, we want to be humble. We want to submit to God. And when we have done that, then there's always a way for us to express ourselves in convincing and effective ways. The last issue of futility that I want to discuss is the idea that we can save ourselves. We know that Jesus died on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. But this is what Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 tells us. "For by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God and not the result of works, so that no one may boast." Now, we know this truth, but often in our minds we think, "I'm not worthy of God's grace and mercy. I've got to do something to be able to earn it." If I ask you why you should get to go to heaven, this is the kind of response that many people might give. "Well, I'm a good person. I teach Sunday school. I sing in the choir. I help with the Christmas bazaar. I give my money to the church. I pray every day. I read my Bible. I try to live by the golden rule. I don't try to intentionally hurt anyone." Now, you might not do all of those things, but you can find yourself in there somewhere. All those things are outstanding, but they're not the reason why we would get to go to heaven receiving the gift of eternal life. The reason we can go to heaven is not because of anything we have done. Even the devil believes in God, but the devil's not welcome in heaven. You can check that out in James chapter 2, verse 19. We get to go to heaven because of what Jesus did for us. We have faith in Jesus that He died for the forgiveness of our sins. He extends grace and mercy to each of us. We believe in the saving faith of Jesus. In Acts chapter 16, verse 31, it says, "Believe," or you could translate that word, "trust on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved." Psalm 103, verse 12 says, "As far as the east is from the west, so far He removes our transgressions from us." God is merciful. God forgives us. Our salvation depends strictly upon the Lord. Well, preacher, what about works? Is there some responsibility on our part? Well, yes, there is. Yes, there is. Once we have been saved, we want to bear fruit for the Lord. This is what Colossians 3:10 says about that. "So that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God." We do things that build the kingdom of God. They don't earn our salvation, but they build God's kingdom. We want to bear fruit to honor God and thank God for this wonderful gift that He has given us in His Son, Jesus. It's futile to think that what we do makes us earn our salvation. The things that we do are evidence of the Holy Spirit working in us. We don't want to be examples of futility in action. We don't want to build our lives on something that isn't real. We want to build our lives on the foundation, that is Jesus the Christ, Peter declared in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, "There's no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." When we put our trust in Jesus, futility is no longer an issue. Now, evil's going to try to drive a wedge between us and the Lord, but all evil can do is try. It has no power over us. With our eyes on Jesus, we can walk in the truth and in the light, showing the world that our strong foundation is built in Jesus Christ our Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, if you've been looking at things that are less than God, if you've been spending your time in futile thinking, pray with me right now. Gracious God, help me to focus on the things that are real in this life, the things that lead to a relationship with you through Christ Jesus, our Savior, bought with His death on the cross and given freely to us as He prayed for the forgiveness of us all. We ask, gracious God, that we can live into that gift, not focusing on things of the world, but focusing on the things that give life today, tomorrow, and into eternity. Father, help us to invite Jesus to be the center of our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now, if you pray that prayer with me, let me know. Give me a call, send me a text, contact me on Facebook, whatever you want to do. I'd be glad to hear from you and talk with you for that.
Please stand. We will sing our final hymn, "Take Time to Be Holy."
Gracious God, we don't want to invest in things that are futile. We want to invest in the one thing that gives life, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Father, teach us the value of that investment. May we give our lives completely and totally to you through Christ our Savior. Amen.